All right, hello, good afternoon, kumusta kayo? And I hope you're all doing well. Welcome sa Usapang Pera live stream dito sa ating YouTube channel. And welcome sa mga first timers na nandito. Ako nga pala si Fitz Villafuerte, ayan, andyan yung pangalan ko. And I am a registered financial planner and nandito ako para tulungan kayo sa mga financial concerns nyo. And as always, mamaya meron tayong Q&A. So kung meron kayong tanong tungkol sa personal finance, even business and investments, pwede tayong mag-usap mamaya. I can answer your questions about personal finance, business and investments. All right, ulit-ulit ako. So kamusta kayo? Hello Raniel Garcia, good afternoon sa iyo. And kay Ate Udeng, yan, good afternoon sa iyo and sa lahat ng mga nandito. Ilan ba 'yung nanonood sa atin ngayon? Wow, 9,000 people ang nanonood sa atin ngayon. And then, so I hope you're all having a good afternoon, a great afternoon. And salamat at nandito kayo at sinasamahan niyo ako sa aking live stream. So this live stream is actually something that I do every week, once a week, usually every Saturday. And kung busy ako ng Saturday, ginawa ko siya ng Sunday. Since naka-ECQ tayo ngayon, taga Metro Manila pala ako. So laging regular for the past 2 months na Sabado tayo tuwing 3 p.m. nagla-live stream. Alright, so hello Johnny, ayan, good afternoon sa iyo. All right. So again, if it's your first time to watch itong ating Usapang Pera live stream, I usually have 3 segments. The first one is yung quotable quotes, and then yung second part is yung topic of the day. And I don't know if you've noticed dun sa cover photo natin, ang topic of the day natin, I will share with you ano ba yung difference ng fixed mindset at saka growth mindset, which is, I think, very important, especially ngayon na wala tayo masyadong ginagawa. And dapat, of course, we make the most out of our quote-unquote free time. And if you have a growth mindset, it will be really beneficial sa'yo. Alright? So, the last part of our live stream, usually mga after mga 30 minutes, usually on the 30th minute mark, is we do our Q&A. And kung meron kayong tanong, you can always ask that sa ating live chat. Ayan, so may mga nagtatype na sa ating live chat. Alright? So, yung live stream natin, it will run for about 1 hour. So, I hope marami kayong matututunan today. No? So, of course, if you are not yet subscribed sa ating YouTube channel, so I hope you can subscribe para ma-notify kayo kapag meron tayong bagong live stream. And of course, I usually edit selected portions of our live streams and I upload it sa channel natin every Mondays, Wednesdays, and Fridays para naman yung sa mga hindi nakapanood at ayaw manood na isang oras na live stream ay they can still learn from the video clips that we will select and upload sa channel natin. Alright? So, I guess that's it for our intro. And let's go to our first part, which is yung ating quotable quotes. So welcome sa ating quotable quote. So this is the part of my live stream where I share with you a meaningful or inspirational quote that I've read online, and I will tell you some of my thoughts about it, no? And yun, good afternoon sa iyo, John Michael. So let me show you our quote for the day. So our quote for the day comes from J.C. Penney, and he says, "It is always the start that requires the greatest effort." So, sino ba itong si J.C. Penney? So, si James Cash Penney. Yun, ibig sabihin nung JC, I'm not sure if you're familiar with yung mga supermarket niya, or supermarket, yung mga department stores niya, or yung brand niya, yung JCPenney. And he's an American entrepreneur and businessman na sobrang sikat sa US, no? And I am really struck by the quote that he said, that it is always the start that requires the greatest effort. Because personally, I've experienced it sa mga projects and businesses na sinimulan ko. Masarap yung part ng umpisa na inspired ka, you have a business idea or meron kang gustong gawin na passion project. And usually, pag nagsimula na tayo to do the work, when we start really making it a reality, meron talagang struggle, even feelings of procrastination and feelings of laziness. Kasi dumadating yung realization natin na, naku, mukhang mahirap itong gagawin ko, or naku, ang dami ko palang kailangan i-consider, ang dami ko palang kailangan i-prepare. And a lot of people, pagdating doon sa point na yon, nade-demotivate, na nawawalan ng energy or nawawalan ng inspiration. And that is actually normal. That's why I believe dito sa sinabi ni JC Penney na it is always the start that requires the greatest effort. Because you have to go over that hurdle na parang mahirap itong gagawin ko. Yung fear, yung feelings of fear natin pagdating sa pag magsisimula tayo ng isang bagay, lalo na pag magsisimula tayo ng business, yun yung isa sa mga kailangan nating i-overcome. Yung feelings of self-doubt, fear, and yung overwhelm na, naku, mukhang mahirap itong pinasok ko. So, yan. What I've learned from experience is that once you start, the momentum starts to build up, the motivation, the inspiration starts to grow again, and yung mga self-doubt mo, usually madidiscover mo na yung mga hindi mo alam, meron palang paraan para malaman sila. Especially if you really share to the world kung ano yung ginagawa mo, more often than not, help will come. And siguro if I can share a specific example that I've done is, yun nga, no, I have a podcast. I started it last January. And to be honest, I've been thinking about starting that ever since, no? Well, not really ever since, but siguro a couple of years ago. But when I start to think of all the things that I need to do, medyo tinatamad ako, nagkakaroon din ako ng fear na anong sasabihin ko, di ba? And naisip ko pa, dadagdag pa yan sa ginagawa ko. But I mustered the courage, and then I started my podcast kahit na from scratch lang, wala akong alam sa audio editing, upload, hindi ako magaling magsalita ng, alam mo, hindi nga ako American English eh. Kasi yung mga pinapakinggan kong podcast, ang gagaling nila magsalita. But along the way, I discovered that there are resources online that could help me become better. And yung initial fear and self-doubt ko, slowly nawala sila, and I discovered that there's a lot of things that I am capable of doing because I discovered it by trying. Okay? So, I guess that's what I really wanted to say. Kung meron kayong gustong simulan, kung meron kayong naiisip na gusto nyong gawin, minsan all you have to do is take a leap of faith and start it, because that's usually the hardest part already, no? And sabi nga ni JC Penney, it's always the start that requires the greatest effort. Okay? So I hope you enjoyed our quotable quote for today, and I hope I am able to inspire you to start something soon, no? So start a project, start a business, and Let's see where it will take you, right? So that's our quotable quote for today. Now, let's go to our topic of the day, which is all about mindset. So let's show the intro. Ayan. So welcome sa ating topic of the day, and for this afternoon, we're going to talk about the difference between the fixed mindset and the growth mindset. So ano bang ibig sabihin ng fixed mindset at saka growth mindset? Madaling, I don't know if you've already encountered these terms, pero medyo common siya na nasishare online. And a lot of times, my friends, share yung anong difference itong dalawang to. But I don't know if they really try to live yung principles ng pagkakaroon ng growth mindset. So, ano ba tong fixed mindset? Ano ba tong growth mindset? And of course, ang importante dyan ay meron tayong growth mindset. But what's the difference? I don't know if you will... let's check kung... Alin ka dito sa dalawang to? Meron akong isishare sa inyo na parang table. Ayan, difference silang dalawa. Ayan, di ba? Magic. Dalawa lang. So, pag sinabi mong fixed mindset, ito yung mga characteristics niya. So, let's go through them one by one. Avoids challenges, gives up easily, sees effort as fruitless, ignores negative feedback, feels threatened by the success of others. Versus yung growth mindset. Pag sinabing growth mindset, these are people who embraces challenges, who persists in the face of challenges. They see effort as path to mastery, learns from criticism, and finds lessons and inspiration in the success of others. So, I often say that pag yung growth mindset, meron kang hunger for knowledge. And of course, hindi nagtatapos ang learning natin pag-graduate tayo ng college, because learning is a lifelong process. And if you maintain that growth mindset, it's always a factor in achieving success in the long run. So I'd like to give you a simple example, lalo na ngayon na marami ako nakikita nagbe-bake ng bread sa social media ngayon. Siguro yun yung mga ginagawa nila ngayon sa bahay, no? And to give you an example, yung pagbe-bake ng bread. So, pag fixed mindset ka, avoid challenges. Siguro sasabihin mo na, hindi man ako marunong mag-bake, anong alam ko dyan, no? Ayoko nga subukan yan. So, that's the fixed mindset. Pero pag growth mindset, uy, interesting to, marami akong kilalang nagbe-bake ng bread. Siguro nga, itatry ko din, di ba? So, embraces challenges. Ngayon, sabihin na natin na, sige, sinubukan mo mag-bake ng bread. And alam nyo ba, I don't know if you're familiar with the baking. Ang baking kasi, hindi siya pareho ng cooking. Sa baking kasi, medyo precise dapat yung mga measurements, precise yung mga temperature. So, mas scientific, I would say, ang baking. Kailangan precise yung mga ginagawa mo. Hindi katulad ng cooking, pag nagluluto ka, madaling i-adjust along the way. So, sa baking, magkamali ka lang ng isang measurement, yung ending mo, hindi masarap, or mali. Pwede hindi mag-rise yung bread, and all the other things that could go wrong. And kung at your first try, mali, or hindi masarap yung nagawa mo, pag fixed mindset ka, naku, ayoko na, sabi ko na nga ba, hindi ako marunong nito. Diba? But of course, pag growth mindset ka, mas namomotivate ka na, sige, gagawin ko siya ulit bukas or next week. I'd like to learn how to do this. So you persist with that challenge. Ngayon, pag fixed mindset ka, you see those effort as fruitless. Iniisip mo siguro na ano naman 'to eh? It's just something that I can do ngayong naka-lockdown ako or naka-quarantine ako dito sa bahay. So, yun lang yung fixed mindset. Pero pag naka-growth mindset ka, pwede mo isipin na, uy, pag na-perfect ko to, siguro I can do this for the long term. Pwede ko siguro tong gawing business, home business, di ba? You see effort as path to mastery. Ibig sabihin, nai-inspire ka na, uy, baka pwede kong itry na after ko mag-bake ng pandesal, siguro try ko naman cookie or cupcake. And then eventually, siguro pag magaling na ako mag-bake, I can do this as a home business and then someday open my own bake shop, di ba? Or bakery. So, I hope you are able to understand ano yung difference ng fixed and growth mindset. And I think it's self-explanatory yung next natin na characteristic, which is ignores negative feedback. So, pwede mo sabihin na, hindi, okay na yan, or ano naman, masarap naman yan, di ba? Pag kiniticize mo yung binake niya. But, of course, as an entrepreneur, it's always important to listen to the feedback of your customers and you learn from the criticisms. Ngayon, itong fixed mindset, pagdating sa feels threatened by the success of others, I've seen this a couple of times, lalo na yung mga nagtatry na mag-aral din sa baking. Sinasabi nila na, uy, marami na namang masarap dyan na cupcake or masarap na mag-bake ng cookies, bakit ko pa siya gagawin business? So, you feel threatened by the success of others. Pero, if you have a growth mindset, ang sinasabi mo sa sarili mo, uy, si ganyan, no? Ang lumaki yung business niya dahil dun sa mga binibenta niyang mga cakes. Gusto ko rin siyang subukan. Nakaka-inspire yung kanyang business venture. So, siguro kaya ko rin yon. So, pag growth mindset ka, you are hungry, you want to achieve more things in life, and hindi nagsa-stop yung sa you don't stop dreaming, you don't just drift through life. Hindi ka happy-go-lucky, but instead you try to find challenges that will help you grow as a person. So that's the basic differences between having a fixed mindset and a growth mindset. So, I hope you learned something new today. And para sa akin, gustong-gusto ko talaga itong differences na to, itong concept nitong fixed mindset and growth mindset. Because sometimes when I am faced by a challenge or I'm planning to start a passion project or explore a business idea, I try to be self-aware and listen to the words that I'm saying. So, pwede, minsan kini-question ko yung sarili ko na ano ba to? Fixed mindset ba tong ginagawa ko or growth mindset? And it's the same siguro, just to give you another example. Nung sinisimulan ko tong live streaming ko, I started live streaming in YouTube siguro mga around October last year. And minsan tinatamad ako kasi sinasabi ko wala namang nanonood or minsan sinasabi ko na hindi mo lang ako magaling magsalita, no? Hindi ako, I believe I'm not as charming as the other YouTubers and other financial coaches na gumagawa ng video, no? Hindi ako kasing galing ni Nas Daily na magsalita and gumawa ng script. But sabi ko, hindi, subukan ko na rin and I'm excited to improve. So, nung na-realize ko na sinasabotage ko yung sarili ko by the words that I'm saying, na-realize ko na I'm stuck with a fixed mindset when it comes to doing this project. But eventually, I was able to overcome it. And yun, nandito na tayo ngayon. Nanonood na kayo ngayon ng live stream ko. And I'm actually enjoying it. I'm probably not the best live streamer out there. And hindi ako yung pinakamagaling magsalita. But the important thing is I am enjoying this, and because I am enjoying what I'm doing, I am always trying to find ways to make this project better. So I hope I am able to inspire you to start something. And with that, let us go to our question and answer part. But before that, o nga pala, usually after the topic of the day, meron akong quote-unquote advertisements. Ayan. So, of course, our first reminder, ayan. If you still haven't done so, then please subscribe to our YouTube channel. I am working my way up to have 1,000 subscribers. So, pag naka 1,000 subscribers tayo, ang promise ko, magkakaroon tayo ng promo or giveaway. Alright? So, we're already past 50% of our goal. So, I hope you can subscribe and also invite your friends to subscribe to our YouTube channel. And, of course, nabanggit ko na kanina, ayan, I have a podcast. It's called The 80%. And it's available sa Apple Podcasts, Google Podcasts, and Spotify. I come out with new episodes every Thursday, right? And ito, some good news sa mga nanonood talaga, nakikinig ng podcast ko. I've been able to partner with Podcast Network Asia, and we have a upcoming fundraising project next week, which is called the Podcast United Stay at Home Give Back. So magla-live stream kami sa YouTube, kaming mga podcasters who are partnered with Podcast Network Asia. And parang Q&A din yon, and usapan, kwentuhan. And I am part of the Tuesday group. Ayan, Tuesday group. It's a one week. From Mondays to Fridays, there will be live streaming. Magkakaroon ng Facebook Live yung mga podcasters in the Philippines. And I am part of the Tuesday group. I am going live with Stanley Chi ng The Underpaid Podcast, si Ronster Baitong ng Hustle Share. And it will start at 7 p.m. ng April 21 on Tuesday. And this is, of course, in partnership with Paymaya and Frontline Feeders Philippines. And we will be... this is a fundraising project for Frontline Feeders Philippines, isang organization. I wouldn't say an organization. Well, they're a group of people who are trying to mobilize yung logistics ng mga restaurants, kitchens, and delivering food packages sa mga frontliners natin para hindi na nila iniisip kung saan sila kakain, hindi nila kailangan lumabas para kumain. And I have friends who are actually frontliners, mga doctors, and they say na malaking tulong daw yung may nagsusupply sa kanila ng pagkain. Dahil minsan daw nakakalimutan na nilang kumain, minsan hindi sila makalabas ng ganung kadali. So at least we are able to feed yung mga frontliners natin. So I hope you will also join us sa Tuesday, 7 p.m. dito sa Podcast United. And you can check out yung link, yung bit.ly/Tuesday Podcast United, para pumunta dun sa Facebook event where I am a part of, and you can siguro signify that you're joining or you're going, para alam namin kung ilan yung mag-a-attend ng aming live stream. So, I hope you will join me sa Tuesday. Alright, so yun na. So, let's go to our question and answer. So welcome sa ating Usapang Pera Q&A. So if you have questions that you want me to answer, then you can just type it sa ating live chat. And yun nga, meron tayong surprise. Surprise pa ba to? So I still have personal accident insurance worth 50,000 pesos courtesy of AXA Philippines na pwede ipamigay. Ayan, Merry Christmas pa rin yung nakalagay kasi nga noong December pa to, hindi ko talaga siya maubos. Ang dami binigay ni AXA Philippines. So, sa mga magtatanong, ayan, bibigyan ko kayo nitong free personal accident insurance worth 50,000 pesos courtesy of AXA Philippines. So, maraming salamat sa AXA for the gift that you sent us for our viewers. Alright? So, nandito na tayo sa Q&A, and if you have any question, you can just ask it sa ating live chat. So, hello sa 12,000 na nanonood. Yan, 12,000 talaga. And Siguro we can start with the question that was sent to me earlier. So there was someone who is asking, ano ba yung mga available cash assistance from the government for this time, no? And I find that an interesting question, kaya medyo nag-research ako. Ayan. I actually have a list already. I'm trying to write an article sa blog ko regarding yung mga available cash assistance that the government is providing. And from my initial research, of course, we have the Department of Social Welfare and Development, yung COVID-19 emergency assistance na 5,000 to 8,000 in cash or and in kind na good for 2 months. This is, of course, for the household and families belonging to vulnerable sectors affected by the pandemic. Okay, so I don't know if you're aware, there are also other government branches who are giving cash assistance. Of course, one of them is SSS or the Social Security System. So meron silang SSS unemployment benefits. So these are for SSS members na nawalan ng trabaho because of the COVID-19. And the cash benefit amount is half of the average monthly salary credit up to 2 months. All right? So I will write about this cash assistance program sa blog ko, particularly ano ba yung requirements and how to apply. But let me just give you a list of the initial research that I've already done. So aside from the SSS unemployment benefit, SSS is also giving out, you can also avail of SSS salary loan, di ba? So you can borrow up to 1 month's worth of your salary kung medyo kailangan mo ng pera during this time, or something that can help you cover your living and medical expenses. And of course, there's also the SSS Calamity Fund, where you can borrow up to 20,000 pesos. Again, this is to help you cover some of your living and medical expenses, right? So the Department of Labor and Employment, or DOLE, meron din silang mga programs, cash assistance programs. Merong COVID Adjustment Measures Program, and this is particularly for workers affected by temporary income reduction or job loss due to the lockdown. So it's available to those employed by small to medium private enterprises that are closed temporarily or are adopting work from home arrangements. So the cash benefit amount is 5,000 pesos. Di ba? Sayang din yun, 5,000 din yun. So the employers must apply, should submit yung mga requirements daw sa DOLE, regional or provincial or field office. So again, check out my blog post about this if you want to learn more, kasi ino-organize ko pa lang yung research ko as of writing. And then, of course, yung mga OFWs, meron din silang cash aid. This is particularly for OFWs who lost their jobs due to COVID-19. So you are eligible for a $200 or I think 10,000 pesos na cash benefit, right? So siguro you can learn about that sa OWA regional office. And then yung Pag-ibig Fund, they also have a calamity fund, and you can avail a loan up to 80% of your total accumulated savings, right? And lastly, na nakita kong benefit na pwedeng nyo makuha ay yung Small Business Wage Subsidy ng Department of Finance. So there's a Small Business Wage Subsidy program na ino-offer ang Department of Finance through SSS, where you can get around 5,000 to 8,000, depending kung ano yung minimum wage dun sa area nyo. Okay? So this is, ang eligible dito ay yung mga small businesses and yung mga employees nitong mga small to medium businesses. Alright? So again, I'll write about this, yung details nitong mga cash assistance programs na ino-offer ng government sa aking blog very soon, siguro within first thing next week. All right, so that's one of the questions that was asked sa akin, and I hope naging useful siya sa inyo. I'm sure useful yan, no? So, ano pa ba yung mga tanong? Ayan, si Ate Udeng, mayroon siyang dalawang tanong. The first one, so tinatanong ni Ate Udeng, ano ang advantages at disadvantages ng paggamit ng business plan sa isang passion project? Example, food blog and videos. Kahit na passion project siya, basta meron kang quote-unquote business plan, at least yung mga kailangan mong gawin, nailista mo na. Kasi para sa akin, madaling gumawa ng idea, madaling ma-excite sa isang idea na gusto mong gawin. Pero pag ginagawa mo na siya at wala kang business plan, minsan may mga nakakalimutan kang gawin or na-overlook. So when you sit down and develop a business plan, you are able to imagine already, excuse me yan. So if you have a business plan, you can already imagine how it is and what are the things that you need to do if you start your passion project or yung business idea mo, pinurso mo siya. And it entails seeing how you will run the business even if it is just on paper. So what am I saying? So kunwari, food blog. If you want to put up a food blog as a passion project, so of course, off the top of your mind, iniisip mo, kailangan mo ng website, di ba? Ang tatanong mo, paano ba ako gagawa ng website? Ay, ano na lang yan? I-search ko na lang yan or maghahanap na lang ako ng free na website or free platform, no? Tapos, ano yung mga isusulat ko? Pwede bang kahit ano na lang? Ano ba yung mga restaurants na mga kinakainan ko? Yun ba yung mga isusulat ko? So, if you try to do this na as you go along, may mga makakalimutan ka na i-consider. So, nung nag-start ako ng isang food blog, isa sa mga nakalimutan kong pag-aralan kasi hindi ako masyad, it's also a passion project, hindi ko siya ginawa ng business plan, was yung pag-take ng pictures. Hindi ko na realize na, of course, para ka mabasa ng mga tao, a big factor pagdating sa food blog ay yung maganda yung itsura ng mga pictures mo. And hindi lang siya kasi basta-basta kukunan yung picture, di ba? You have to learn how to properly frame and even edit some of the pictures. So, when I realized that, sabi ko, nako, if I want to someday monetize itong food blog ko, I have to learn some of these things. So, when you sit down and then you imagine yourself already doing the project, yung mga little details na to, it will come up. Diba? And of course, you have to consider, paano ko hahanap ng mga readers? Diba? Paano ko siya i-market? So, mailalagay mo yung step by step na, okay, after nito, kailangan kong magsimula ng Facebook page. Kasi yung mga blogs, usually meron din silang Facebook page. And then, tatanungin mo yung sarili mo, kailangan ko bang gumawa ng Twitter account? Kailangan ko bang gumawa ng Instagram account? Diba? So, you will be less likely to do trial and error, di ba? Kasi meron kang plan, tapos bago ka pa man magsimula na mag-execute, bago ka pa man mag-register ng domain name mo, meron ka ng mga listahan ng mga to do and hindi ka mawawala. Tsaka there's such a thing called Zeigarnik effect. I don't know if you've heard of it. It's a concept that was discovered or studied by a psychologist na once you start something, and then mahirap siyang itigil, di ba? So, kapag you're just doing something out of your head, yung listahan mo na sa utak mo lang, may times na may makakalimutan kang gawin, tapos wala ka rin physical manifestation nung project mo. So, less yung motivation mo to finish what you started. Pero, kung meron kang listahan, umupo ka isang araw, dalawang araw talaga nilista mo all the things that you need to do to be able to execute your passion project. Meron kang 100 items na list. I guarantee you, magkakaroon ka ng nagging feeling na gusto mong matapos yung 100 na to-do list mo. And of course, yung to-do list mo na yon, that is enough for you to, alam mo yon, come up with at least a minimum viable product of what you're trying to start, no? Even if it's just a food blog or if it's a simple business idea. And I guarantee you, the motivation is higher. The inspiration to finish what you've started is you'll be motivated more. You will be more motivated to finish what you started, right? So, yun nga, even if it doesn't have to be a formal business plan, no? You don't have to download a template ng business plan. But at the very least, have a to-do list and then add a little bit of detail dun sa mga kailangan mong gawin. Ano ba yung mga ini-expect mong challenges when you start doing this part? And I guarantee you, yung pag-execute mo ng plan mo, it will be much easier, right? So that's my opinion regarding your question, no? So ano ang disadvantage? Of course, ang disadvantage is you cannot predict everything. So, ang maganda dyan is, isang advantage dyan, if something unexpected happens, you can now focus on how to solve that obstacle. Because you don't have to, meron ka ng plano, so you can ask yourself, ano ba yung kailangan kong gawin so that I can go back on track? But of course, yun nga, ang disadvantage dyan is, kapag sobrang unexpected yung nangyari, di ba? You're not prepared for that. Sometimes you have to change your strategy. And yun yung unfortunate na kung nasa step number 20 ka na, siguro kung talagang unexpected yung nangyari, baka mamaya yung step number 30 to 100 mo, kailangan mo nang baguhin. So inisip mo, sayang yung effort mo nung umpisa, no? Talagang nag-effort ka na isulat yung 100 steps mo, tapos yung pala babaguhin mo rin pala in the middle. Pero what if hindi nangyari yung unexpected na yun? At least, di ba, smooth sailing ka from 1 to 100. So yun yung major disadvantage. But from my experience, that's one of the reasons kung bakit exciting mag-start ng isang passion project, kung bakit exciting magsimula ng business, itong mga challenges na ganito. And more often than not, you won't have to set aside all the things that you planned. Minsan, there's always a way for you to go back on track. Okay? So, yun. And maraming salamat, Ate Udeng. Yan. Nananalo ka ng 50,000 pesos worth of personal accident insurance. So, mamaya, bibigyan ko kayo ng instructions kung paano makiklaim. No? So, yung question number two mo, kung nasa field ka na, hindi masyadong kilala locally, may recommended jump point po ba para sa research and na makabunang magandang business plan? Okay. Kung nasa field ka na hindi masyadong kilala locally, hindi ko masyadong maintindihan, sorry. Pero, I believe what you're asking is, pagdating sa market research, if hindi masyadong popular yung business idea mo na gustong gawin, well, minsan you would have to do it the old-fashioned way, which is go out and do your research na sa mga, I don't know, libraries or government offices. And from what I've experienced in the past, there's always information out there, but you just have to know where and how to get it, right? Especially sa mga micro-niche, or alam mo yun, hindi masyadong popular na mga topics or na hindi basta-basta masi-search sa online or mag-google, you have to find an expert or find an authority dun sa topic na yon. And sometimes, kung lalo na kung professor or a scientist yung kailangan mong tanungin about that, social scientist man yan or scientist na in the field of a specific field, minsan you have to call their office, set an appointment, etc. And more often than not, they're very generous with sharing their ideas. And some of my personal experience pagdating sa pagtatayo ng business or pag pupursue ng isang business idea, nakakahanap naman ako ng pwedeng kausapin. Yung mga business networking ng mga events, of course, wala sila ngayon kasi naka-quarantine tayo. But when things start to go back to normal, you try to attend yung mga business seminars or conventions, mga trade fairs, summits, because networking will always help in connecting you to someone who could provide the information that you might need dun sa iyong passion project or business venture that you're planning. Right? So, yun. Jump point ang gusto mo. You can search Google ng specific na mga experts, no? Pwede mong tanungin na someone who, kunwari, mag-isip tayo ng magandang example. Sabihin natin, yung isa kong kasing friend, gumagawa siya ng mga moringa cake, alright? So, kasi sabi niya, healthy daw yung malunggay and all. So, kunwari, yun yung field na gusto mong pasukin. Just an example. Pwede kang mag-search sa internet ng mga moringa research scientist, di ba? Pwede yon. Or mga, since it's a vegetarian or it's a vegan product siguro, di ba? Moringa vegan cake supplier, di ba? So, you will be able to find mga businesses and offices and probably people who can talk about, who can help you with the information that you need. I can also recommend searching yung Facebook, mga Facebook groups. Sometimes may mga expert communities sa Facebook. And I can also recommend searching yung mga online forums. So, check yung pinoyexchange.com, check nyo yung reddit.com, yan, mga online forums. Sometimes, may mga niche communities dyan, no? Meron ako nakita sa Facebook, isang Facebook group, ang pinag-uusapan lang nila is tungkol sa hobby ng ant colony. Alam nyo ba yon? Although, nagsimula yon kasi meron akong friend na nag-join daw siya ng isang Facebook group na i-assign ka ng isang number, tapos magiging part ka ng isang ant colony. So, it's a humorous Facebook group. Okay? So, entertainment lang siya. However, there's someone dun sa Facebook group na masipag mag-post. And nung tinignan ko yung profile niya, apparently, hobbyist siya ng isang, yung mga mahilig mag-collect ng mga ant farms. So, yun yung hobby niya. And dun sa profile niya, meron pa siyang specific group na yung mga ant colony hobbyist na ant farm collectors. Andun sila, no? At medyo malaki din yung group, mga more than 5,000. So, alam mo yun, napaka-obscure na nung hobby, pero meron pa rin Facebook group na nag-uusap sila dun sa topic na yun. So, you would need to be a little bit resourceful, but yes, the jump off point mo is siguro search for it sa Facebook. If there's a Facebook group, you can search sa Google if there's like an online forum or a website where people talk about yung nire-research mo. Ayan. Okay? So, teka lang, isusulat ko muna yung pangalan mo, Ate Udeng. Ayan. So, congratulations. Meron kang personal accident insurance worth 50,000 from AXA Philippines. Alright. So, sabi ni John Michael Mercurio, "Sir, how did you start your first business? What was your first step? And did you quit your job immediately after you started?" Well, I don't know kung ano yung pwedeng ma-qualify na first business ko. Kasi ang first business ko talaga ay nagtitinda ako ng squid balls sa sari-sari store namin. Kasi meron kami sari-sari store noon. And pag summer, syempre wala akong baon. And syempre gusto ko rin gumimik. gusto kong lumabas kasama ng mga classmates ko kahit bakasyon. So ang ginawa ko noon, through the permission of my parents, ay nagtitinda ako ng squid balls sa tapat ng sari-sari store namin. So technically that's my first business. But yung first legal or official na business ko was a computer shop. And ang nangyari dyan was yung isa kong office mate dati, meron siyang nakitang computer shop na for sale sa Makati. Pero kulang yung ipon niya. So naghahanap siya ng business partner. Okay? So tatlo kami dun sa opisina na nag-pitch in para bilhin yung computer shops ko. Kasi yung may-ari ng computer shop mag-a-abroad na raw. And it was just around 6 computers. So tinake over namin siya and nag-alternate kami sa pagpunta doon sa computer shop namin after dinner kasi doon nagsasara. So yun yung pinaka first business namin. Of course we kept our jobs kasi hindi naman ganun kalaki yung kinikita namin. And after almost a year, napansin namin na parang hindi worth it yung effort namin kasi almost break even lang kami, especially hindi naman namin matutukan talaga yung business. However, what we've learned is that, well, ako personally, what I've learned is natutunan ko kung paano magpatakbo ng isang computer shop, di ba? Alalaman ko, nagkaroon ako bigla ng contact sa mga computer parts supplier, nalaman ko kung ano ba yung mga usong game sa mga kabataan, ano ba yung tamang strategy pag makikipag-usap ka sa mga customers mo, etc. And of course, I was able to get acquainted sa legal business, sa legalities ng pagtatayo ng isang business kasi ako yung nag-asikaso nung from the barangay permit up to the BIR registration. Ako yung nag-volunteer na mag-asikaso noon. So, nalaman ko siya. So, eventually, the computer shop closed down. Sinara namin siya. But, it gave me an idea na why not put up my own. I just have to find a better location and see if I can revive that. So, it took me a couple of years and siyempre, ako na lang mag-isa yung tutuloy ng computer shop or magsisimula ng computer shop. I needed capital and naisip ko, one of the things that I can do to save money for a business capital is to do some freelance work. So, from there, I started doing freelancing and eventually, na-realize ko na masarap pala maging freelancer and dumating sa point na yung kinikita kong pera as a freelancer, it's almost equal dun sa sweldo ko as an engineer. Yeah? So, I was a systems analyst and I did freelance software development. Self-study yun kasi sabi sa akin nung isa kong friend ay marami daw opportunity sa mga IT noon. So, nagsi-self-study ako noon. Diba? Growth mindset. Eventually, I had the courage to resign from work. Kasi nga, kaya nang isustain yung lifestyle ko nung freelance income ko. And then, of course, ang naisip ko kasi, isa sa mga goals ko talaga was to start a business. And yung freelancing ko, I tried to create a software development company, but I guess yung computer shop was really the one that was meant for me. Kasi meron na akong prior experience to running a computer shop, and it was just a matter of coming up with the business capital. So I was able to save a substantial amount, but I was also sabihin na natin na blessed by meeting a friend of my father who pitched in. Nagustuhan niya yung business idea ko ng computer shop And bumaka siya. And because of that, I was able to put up my business. Ito siguro yung isa sa mga pinaka-successful na business ko, yung computer shop, because I was lucky to be able to catch yung rise ng Ragnarok at saka Dota. Kasi nandun, nagsimula kami ng computer shop sa Makati, Counter-Strike at saka Red Alert lang yung talaga nilalaro ng mga bata at saka Battle Realm. So yung mga LAN gaming. So hindi pa uso nun yung mga MMORPG. So I was able to put up my shop during that time na nagsisimula pa lang siya. So it was really a profitable business for me na talagang siya yung nag-fund ng mga next businesses ko after that. So siguro the lesson that I want you to learn is huwag kang magre-resign basta-basta. Think about your plan carefully. And of course, importante na meron kang source of income that can sustain your daily cost of living. So in my case, I used freelancing to cover yung daily cost of living ko. So even I grew my freelancing career through that also. And then kung nung almost pareho na yung kinikita ko sa freelancing ko versus sa trabaho ko sa opisina, that's when I resigned, and then that's when I started focusing on putting up my business. Right? So yun yung short na life story ko. And I hope may natutunan ka or may nakuha kang lesson dun sa ginawa ko. So, don't quit your job immediately. Siguro yun yung pwede kong take away sa'yo. Make sure that there's something that will replace your income when you quit your job. And if you don't want to go through the freelancing route, you can always try to find a way to immediately start your business kahit na nag-uopisina ka. Then when your business starts to earning regularly, when it starts to become stable, then that's when you resign. Kasi alam mo ba, yung office mates mo, sometimes they become your first customers also. Sometimes they can be your network when you need something for your business, right? So yun, actually yung computer shop namin, yung mga suppliers namin ng mga computer parts, kasi minsan naman nasisira yung video card, kailangan namin ng bagong mouse, etc. Ang nangyari nun, kinausap namin yung procurement department ng opisina namin, kinuha namin yung supplier sila ng mga computer parts sa opisina. So alam mo yun, nakatipid kami. So take advantage na nag-opisina ka pa rin, kasi pwede mo i-leverage yung employment mo in networking, right? So yun. So, congratulations John Michael Mercurio. Ayan, nasilista ko yung pangalan mo. So, John Michael Mercurio. Okay? So, congratulations. Meron kang 50,000 pesos worth of personal accident insurance courtesy of AXA Philippines. So, sabi ni Wensi. Si Wensi. Ayan. Susulat ko na kagad yung pangalan mo. Para hindi ko na ino-note mamaya. Si Wensi Miguel Guzman. Yan. Pero bago ko sagutin yung tanong mo, iinom muna ako ng tubig. Okay, so hello Wensi. So tanong niya, hi Sir Fitz, would you consider it redundant to have an equity index fund, consumer equity index fund, and infrastructure equity index fund all at the same time, or a good diversification strategy? Thanks in advance. Well, it's a little bit redundant because all of it is in the stock market, di ba? Particularly, yung performance ng stock market, regardless if it is a growth fund or an equity fund or an index fund, pag bumagsak ang stock market, lahat yung bagsak. Ang maganda kasi sa diversification is, when something goes down, hindi affected dapat lahat ng investment mo. So, it would be good to have siguro bonds or money market fund, or if you have access to cooperatives or mga savings and loans association, you can probably check if they have investment. So, yun yung medyo magandang diversification strategy. If you want to venture into real estate or venture into investing in a business, then that's also good. Ngayon, in terms of your stock market portfolio, I would say na it's a little diversified, little lang, sobrang konti lang. Bakit? Kasi pag equity index fund, I'm assuming it's invested in all the companies dun sa that makes up the country's index. So kung baga sa atin, yung PSEI, no? The Philippine Stock Market Composite Index, yun yung equity index fund. Pag sinabi mong consumer equity index fund, probably ito yung mga major players sa na mga companies in the consumer sector. So ito siguro mga SM, Pure Gold, etc. Okay? So pag sinabi mong infrastructure equity fund, probably ito yung mga major players sa real estate industry ng country. So alam mo yon, diversified siya in a way kasi iba-ibang sectors ka, magkaibang sector yung consumer tsaka yung infrastructure. So diversified ka in that sense. Pero yung equity index fund, syempre it is dun sa overall na performance nung country. So major players, major companies dun sa particular country. So you are diversified in terms of the sector, but you are not really diversified in terms of asset class. Okay? And you are also not diversified in terms of risk kasi lahat yan stock market, so lahat yan high risk. So my suggestion is, if you are looking for diversification, hindi lang basta-basta, dapat magkaibang asset class. So pwedeng bonds, pwedeng tawag dito, fixed income funds or money market, etc. So if you want to diversify in terms of risk, you can also invest in mga low risk kasi mga high risk yan. Okay? So I guess you can check out I believe I have a live stream na ang topic natin ay diversification. So you can also check that out, all right? So si Jomar. Hello Jomar, ayan. May yung mga suki ko, ang dami niyo na nakuhang ano no. Personal accident insurance, which is para sa akin okay lang, ibigay niyo na sa kamag-anak nyo, kaibigan nyo, or sa jowa. Jowa talaga. No? So, congratulations sa Wensi. So, Jomar, so, sir, do people get commission on copy, people trading at eToro? Depende kung gaano karami yung kumukopya sa kanila. So, for example, this is just an example. Kuwari ako, I actively trade sa eToro, for example. And then, people started copying me. Kung ang kumukopya sa akin ay konti lang, I think if it's less than 100 people, wala akong nakukuha doon. Wala akong commission doon. Ngayon, there's a threshold which is I am not familiar with. Pag umabot doon sa particular point yung kumukopya sa akin, eToro will contact me and tell me that a portion of the spread that they earn will be shared sa akin. Okay? So, I will now start getting quote-unquote commission, which is basically I will now start getting a portion of the spread. So, kung yung spread, which is how forex brokers make money, sabihin na natin na this is not what the exact amount. So, sabihin na natin na siguro 60% of the spread goes to the forex broker, yung 40% of the spread now starts to be shared sa akin. So that will now be my motivation na galingan na mag-trade. Galingan ko mag-trade para mas maraming kumopya sa akin. Okay? So of course, the more people who copies me, the higher yung pwede kong kitain sa commission from the spread. And of course, kapag hindi ko ginalingan, people will now start to leave me. They will stop copying me. So bababa rin yung commission ko. So mayroong motivation to continue. And I think it's a good arrangement with eToro kasi when they see someone na magaling na trader, inooffera nila na an extra way to make money and of course, a reason not to leave the platform, di ba? So, yes, people get commission on copy trading, yung kinokopya. Ngayon, kung ikaw yung kumokopya, wala kang, of course, wala kang commission. But you make money from the successful trades of the people that you are copying. So, yun yung sagot ko sa tanong mo, Jomar. So, I hope that was the question that you wanted to be answered. No? I hope yun yung gusto mong malaman, Jomar. Right? So, again, salamat sa AXA Philippines for the personal accident insurance that you're giving away. So, yung sa mga nanalo, which is si Ate Udeng, si John Michael Merculio, Wensi, si Jomar, all you have to do is send an email sa work email ko, which is at readytoberich@gmail.com. So, send kayo ng email dyan. Sabihin nyo nanalo kayo dito sa Usapang Pera live stream and I will send you the code. And yung code na yon, of course, kung nanalo na kayo dati, pwede nyo ipamigay sa iba. And make sure that you just register it before April 30 kasi April 30 yung deadline niya for registration. So, again, sa mga nanonood, ayan, may 10,000 people tayo na nanonood. 10,000 talaga. Hello. So, please remember to subscribe to our YouTube channel and also invite your friends para mas dumami tayo dito. And kung libre kayo sa April 21, Tuesday at 7 p.m., I hope you can join me and si Mr. Stanley Chi tsaka si Ronster ng Hustler Share. Because we are going to do a Facebook Live, this is part of the Podcast United project where we try to raise funds for the frontliners. We are in partnership with Paymaya and Frontline Feeders Philippines. So during this Facebook Live, magkukwentuhan kami and we will also answer your questions. Si Stanley Chi, of course, yung underpaid podcast, it's all about employment, no? So, para sa mga nagtatrabaho. Tapos, si Ronster ng Hustle Share, this is all about business. And then, the 80%, it's all about personal finance and investment. So, tungkol sa pagtatrabaho at pagninegosyo at kaperahan, yung pag-uusapan namin tatlo. So, I hope you can join us. So, all you have to do is go to the link, yung bit.ly/TuesdayPodcastUnited at makakapunta kayo dun sa Facebook event kung saan you can join and signify that you're going para ma-remind kayo on Tuesday and 7 p.m. But of course, Podcast United, it's a project that will happen all throughout the week, Monday to Friday. Each day, iba-ibang mga Filipino podcasters ang mag-Facebook Live. So, I'm part of the Tuesday group. So, I hope that I will be able to have you there at magkukwentuhan pa rin tayo sa Tuesday. Alright? So, yun. Uy, nakaisang oras na tayo. So, siguro last, kung mahilig kayo sa podcast, I hope you can check out, ayan nga, yung The 80% Podcast. You can check it out sa Apple Podcast, sa Google Podcast, at saka sa Spotify. Search nyo lang sa Spotify, makikita nyo siya. Type nyo lang The 80% or i-type nyo yung pangalan ko, Fitz Villafuerte, makikita nyo rin siya doon. Alright? So, balik tayo sa Q&A. Mayroon pa bang gusto magtanong? Siguro last question na tayo. Ayan, si August Alvin Guillen. Okay? So, ilalagay ko na yung iyong pangalan. Ayan, August Alvin. Ayan, so, tanong ni August, good afternoon, Sir Fitz. What do you think of a peer-to-peer lending business? I am starting to lend money to my office mates at 10% interest per month. Is it a good investment? Thank you po. Okay, so one of the challenges that I've discovered pagdating sa lending business ay yung pagbabayad. So, my mom started something similar pero sa SM gift checks yung ginagamit niya. So, I believe parang 4% yung interest niya doon sa SM gift checks na pinapahiram niya. So, kung gusto mo ng parang umutang, quote-unquote, bibigyan kanya ng SM gift check para pang grocery sa SM. Tapos, alam ko 2 gives eh. So, 2 bayaran. And of course, my mom was able to get discount din sa pagbili ng SM gift check. So, medyo malaki yung kinikita niya. At the start, it was great. And on time magbayad. But when, of course, there will come a point na someone will have some financial difficulty. And nung nangyari yon, nag-start na yung nahihirapan siyang maningil. Okay? So, eventually, my mom stopped doing that because sabi niya, ayaw niyang makaaway yung mga Mars niya, yung mga kumari niya, ayaw, yung mga kapitbahay namin, ayaw daw niyang makaaway kasi hindi siya makasingil. So, ang ginawa na lang niya ay eventually, hinintay niyang mabayaran siya lahat and then in-stop niya na. So, from that experience, I don't know if it will be the same for you. Of course, iba-iba tayo. You think about your contingency plan in case na yung mga office mate mo, they start to default on their payments. Okay? So, ano yung gagawin mo? Mahirap din kasing sinisequester yung ATM. Alam ko sa mga opisina, kinukuha yung ATM, di ba? So, from what I believe, legally speaking, bawal yun. Hindi pinapayagan ng banko na ipasequester yung ATM sa ibang tao. So, technically, you are stealing na yung ATM nila, no? Kasi hindi sa'yo yung ATM. So, I don't know how you can make a contingency plan out of that. But, dun some people who I know who started a lending business, once na straighten out or na iron out nila yung challenge of how do you make people pay on time, ayan, naging magandang business siya. Okay? I'm specifically thinking about yung isa kong nakilala na nagpapautang siya sa mga sari-sari stores. Okay? So, pang bili ng paninda. Pero ang ceiling nung pwedeng utangin sa kanya was 5,000 pesos lang. Okay? Kasi sabi niya, ang target market niya ay mga sari-sari stores lang. Tapos, hindi lahat nung umuutang sa kanya, pinapautang niya. Tinitingnan niya kung maayos ba talaga yung sari-sari store, marami bang bumibili, and titingnan niya kung talaga bang kailangan yung pera dahil pambili ng paninda or pang-personal. So, kung pang-personal, hindi niya pinapautang. Pero pag yung inuutang na pera ay para pandagdag sa ibebenta, pinapautang niya. And yun yung na-discover niya na since yung pera ay ginagamit para palaguin yung negosyo nila, the rate nung pagbabayad sa kanya was really high. Sabi niya, more than 90% nung humihiram sa kanya, nababayaran siya. Well, particularly, number one, mababa lang kasi pinapautang niya. Pangalawa, yun nga, ginagamit sa negosyo. So, siguro, of course, I don't want to meddle with your business, but sometimes, or I think it would be also good to know the reason why they are borrowing money. Kasi, the reason might be able to help you in ensuring na mababayaran ka. And of course, kapag the business is starting to grow, yung peer-to-peer lending business mo, I hope you register it as legally because it will also help you kasi baka mamaya mayroon kang disgruntled borrower, bigla kang isumbong sa BIR na meron kang illegal na negosyo. So that you won't get into trouble. From what I know, if you're starting a home-based business, pag lumampas ng 200,000 pesos ang profit mo, you are now required or magiging mandatory na for you to register it as a business. So kung rumaraket ka lang and less than 200,000 pa lang yung kinikita mo, okay pa lang yan. It is considered as a freelance thing, no? Pero once lumagpas na ng 200,000, I think, I'm not sure with the exact figure, but it is around that figure. Pag dumampas na ng ganong kalaki yung kinikita mo, it now becomes mandatory for you to register it as a business. Alright, Ogo? So good luck sa iyong peer-to-peer lending business. And mataas yung 10%, ha? Pero of course, mas mababa pa rin yan kaysa sa Bombay, di ba? Sa mga 5-6, kasi 20% yon. So of course, any business idea is a good investment if you know how to properly execute it. So again, sit down, probably create a business plan for it. Yung mga contingency plan when people start to default on their payments. So you have to think about that before you go ahead and grow yung iyong peer-to-peer lending business. Kasi I'm sure kapag okay yan, yung mga friends of friends ng office mates mo, di ba, lalapit na rin sa'yo yan. So what do you do when people you don't know already start to approach you? Di ba? So yan yung mga considerations. So, but good luck on that venture. Okay, so I would encourage you to research on the legality of your business. I mean, ano ba yung mga licenses that you need to apply for if you want to really formalize that business venture of yours. All right. So thank you, August, for that wonderful question. Next, your wonderful question talaga. So ayun. I think that's our last question kasi medyo nagda-dry na yung aking nalamunan. So, maraming salamat sa lahat na nag-participate and congratulations sa mga nanalo ng ating personal accident insurance. So again, thank you sa AXA. And sa mga nagtanong, you can email me at readytoberich@gmail.com for you to receive the registration code. Alright? So, ayun. So, let me say goodbye. So thank you for watching. So please like and subscribe sa ating YouTube channel. And of course, check out my website, readytoberich at fitzvillaferte.com. I am going to write about the list of cash assistance na available from the government na pwede nyo siguro ma-avail soon, no? Probably mid next week. Kasi I'm still doing research. So, if you want to learn more about that, you can check out my website next week. But, of course, you can visit my website now and read some of the articles that I've written there. Okay? So, thank you guys for watching. I really appreciate na nakitambay kayo sa akin. So, again, hopefully, let's see each other again on Tuesday. Okay? So, Facebook Live yan. Just go to the link to signify that you're going and to get reminded soon dun sa Podcast United na live stream. And with that, let me say goodbye and hope you have a great weekend. Alright? Teka, tatanggalin natin yung ano yan. Bye-bye! Yan. So, bye-bye. Take care.